Key Trends for the CMO in 2018. Please welcome Alison Lewis and Matt Spiegel. Come on out.
Room.
Yeah.
Well, hello, Alison.
Hello.
How are you?
I'm very good. Very
thanks
good.
For joining us.
I'm happy to be here.
Yeah, cool. So as we spend a little time, and as I've talked in the past about what we're going to talk about today and what's big in 2018, there are a couple key themes that kept coming up. Obviously, a lot was around the consumer patterns in commerce, and we'll talk a little about that. Speed and agility became an important topic. And then kind of the broadening of what you guys do as a company was a topic as well. So as we go through that, I thought the right place to start is with the consumer,
yes. Right?
Which we, I think, try and do as often as we can.
As often as we can.
And for you guys, there's a lot in there, right? Certainly e-commerce, and I know, as you'll talk about, connected commerce is something you guys have to care a lot about, which is different from where J&J has historically been. Yeah. We've in a world where e-commerce is growing rapidly, but the stat I wrote down was $450 billion of e-commerce in the U.S. in 2017. I also, as you know, looked up the stat that said Alibaba did $25 billion of sales in one day, right, in China. So that's one company, one day in China. So clearly hot. Your category is typically less penetrated in e-commerce, but the growth rate, I saw a study from UBS, is up, going to be up big. So that's consumer packaged goods, however you want to qualify that, health and beauty.
Yep.
So I guess with that backdrop, and as you think about following the consumer and this idea of connected commerce and what that means for you guys in 2018 and beyond, I guess I'll just ask, what does that mean?
Yeah, it's a great question, and it is a huge shift that we're dealing with, because if you think about the world of packaged goods that I've actually spent my whole career in, at the end of the day, we sell through third parties. So we sell through the Walmarts, the Targets, the Tescos, the Watsons, wherever around the world. And all of a sudden with e-commerce, while yes, you are selling through a third party, in the case of e-commerce or omnichannel, if it's Target.com or Walmart.com, you have to think much more like a retailer than you've ever had to think before. And so the key thing is sort of turning our brand marketers into more performance marketers. And the exciting thing about that is it forces us to really become more experience-based marketers. And I think we talk about the experience economy often and how we are shifting to an experience economy. And it's really technology that's facilitated these experiences that you can get that result in the fact that we can't ever go back. So it's sort of irreversible, these changes. And so the experience that someone gets in getting something in 2 hours from Amazon.com, or a deeper experience they might have through some sort of, .com site, they want that experience in everything they do, whether that's online or offline. And so it's really shifting us to be more experience focused. Yeah. In terms of e-commerce itself, I can talk a little bit about sort of the changes that we've had to make. And, they're not easy, as I said, because you have to shift this mindset of being more of a performance marketer. And you also have to get rid of silos in terms of, sales in one silo and marketing in one silo and supply chain in another silo, and have everybody working together as one team. But the key thing is, I think, when it comes to e-commerce, it's all about, first, you got to get those fundamentals right. So those fundamentals are all about sort of building that infrastructure to allow you to do, search really well, to allow you to have the right content online, to allow you to have your ratings and reviews, because we all know, you really need a rating and review at 3.7 or above, or you got a problem, you got to fix that problem. And so getting all those sort of fundamentals in line are really critical. But then I always say that's really about sort of the fundamentals of the pure play, so the Amazons or the Alibabas of the world, but then you've got the omni-channels, which are also sort of the Targets, the Tescos.coms, the Walmart.coms, et cetera. So that's kind of in that world. Yeah. The thing that you need to move to next, which is the even bigger change, I think, for organizations like ours, are building sort of these connected ecosystems and what I call sort of overarching connected commerce, and moving to your offerings being less about just a product in itself, which packaged goods typically sells products, and bringing in sort of a service. Mm-hmm. So a couple of, you know, good examples just to make that real of what we're doing, which I love, because I'll tell you, the best part about my job is that things are moving so quickly today that you're constantly learning and growing. But it's things like, you know, launching our first, you know, direct-to-commerce site in Neutrogena.com, where we actually sell product direct to the consumer. And what's fascinating about that is when we do that, and we had a Neutrogena.com site that wasn't, you know, fully DTC enabled. And you know, when we relaunched with full direct-to-consumer enabled site, what that resulted in is definitely increased traffic flow, definitely increased transactions. And so it allows us to be direct marketers to our consumers like never before and really give them a deeper, richer experience, which at the end of the day is what we've always done in brand management, which is, you know, create loyalty and love for our businesses. And another thing we just recently launched at CES, and we're pretty proud to talk about it because we won an Editor's Choice Award from USA Today, is the Neutrogena 360 skin scanner with FitSkin. And that's a scanner that goes onto your phone where you can measure moisture, you can measure pore size, and you can measure wrinkles. And then it basically gives you recommendations of what you should be doing with your skin, for your skin, and what products you should be using, and then measure that over time. And if you're making progress, great. If you're not making the progress, additional recommendations. So that's just a great example of sort of more that connected commerce, connected ecosystem that you've got to get in place.
So it's interesting because these examples, this move into services, I mean, that's a big change.
Big change.
Right? And even thinking about yourselves as a performance marketer, not just a brand marketer, big change.
Yep.
But these things together are not just about marketing, right? I mean, this is across the organization.
Yes.
I guess the question there is, how is that going for J&J, and maybe more directly, as the CMO of the organization, how are you helping to spearhead these kind of organizational changes that have to make that possible? I mean, you know, this has got to be a journey you guys are on. This isn't an overnight reality.
Absolutely. So I think there's two things I'll say that you know, sort of are the broader changes that you've got to drive. And my guess is many of your organizations are facing this. But the first I would say is the whole ability to learn as you go and sort of accept failure.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're not going to be perfect when you're working in these new areas. You are not. I mean, there is no, it's constant learning and it's constantly changing. So you have to be very comfortable with failure. And big companies typically aren't as comfortable with that. You know, they're all about managing against risk, not managing to risk. And so you've got to get more comfortable with that. So that's one thing I'll say. And then the other thing I'll say is just agility, that ability to sort of move quickly. And so we're doing a lot of work there around really looking at agile methodologies and putting in place more 30-day sprints. Again, very different, you know, defining a problem that we're trying to solve, and 30 days we're going to have cracked this part of the problem, and then the next 30 days we're going to crack this part of the problem, and it allows us to go with more speed and learn as we go, which links to that sort of failure piece. Instead of trying to get it perfect out the gate, we get it to a point in 30 days and we sort of see, okay, how's that working? All right, that's not working. We'll fix that and we'll move on. So those are the kinds of things we're doing.
And where are we on that journey? Is 2018, as we think about the next 12 months, is this the beginning of that process? Are we in the early innings? Meaning, again, you know, we obviously from externally, all of us watch organizations and we see this change. We see the discussion happening.
Right.
We see now activity. I feel that we're beyond just the hype of it all, that clearly motion is in progress, that the organizations are changing. But do you think of it as, is 2018 a critical year in that process? Are we beyond walking, or beyond crawling, we're walking? What's your sense?
So I think it is a critical year. I mean, I sort of hold up for the organization that this is the year of leapfrog. Mm. You know, we want to always hold that big high bar out for ourselves. I'm not sure we're going to fully get there, if I'm really honest, but the point is, if you set the goal this high, then if you get this high, you're better off than, you know, not having set the goal higher. Yeah. So I think it's the year of leapfrog, but I think you've got to put things in place that sort of allow that. And so, you know, there's sort of some fundamental things that we're doing to help sort of instill that change in the organization. And, you know, one of them is, you know, we do annually sort of a marketing awards internally. It's called the Jim Burke Awards, and Jim Burke was one of our famed CEOs for Johnson & Johnson for many years, and so we honor him with this marketing awards show every year that we do globally. It's run around the world. And so we just introduced a category for this year, which is Fail Forward. Which is a bold move for us, simply because this is all the marketers from around the world, across our pharmaceutical, medical device, and consumer groups, and I'm the head of marketing for the consumer group, the packaged goods side of the business, submitting sort of Fail Forward awards, and then having those presented in front of Alex Gorsky, our chairman and CEO, and the executive and management committee, which are, you know, is a big deal. And so that is a huge sort of way to instill cultural change where leadership is looking for this. And then the other thing I think I mentioned, which is really putting these agile teams in place and really trying to measure, you know, are we making progress in terms of time to market with our innovation, as an example, but these innovation teams and these agile teams are really critical.
I think that's great. I think it's really interesting. Too many organizations don't seem to hit the cultural part of this change.
Yes.
So I think that's an interesting one. And using awards makes a lot of sense.
Yes.
One of the connected topics that we've spent time talking about over time is, of course, the infrastructure. As you said, there's a couple different pieces of it. One of the key things is the data that you have and the intelligence you have.
Yes.
Not necessarily the raw data, but what the business insights that you have access to that you can make new decisions.
Yes.
That's a key to funding or enabling the agility.
Yep.
Another one of these long journeys. Where are you guys on this kind of data intelligence journey as you enter 2018?
So it's a huge focus. So you figure out all that other stuff we're doing is you got to have a data infrastructure.
Yeah.
Massive focus is building that. And I think traditionally we've tended to outsource that because, again, we've been someone who has sold through a third party, therefore never really owned the primary, you know, the primary data or the primary consumer. But we're building that, and we're building that to bring it from just having it outsourced with sort of the Nielsen's of the world or at IPG and Universal McCann, our media partner, still working very closely with them, but also insourcing a lot more of that and really building the data strategy, the data infrastructure, and the data governance globally in order to allow us to, you know, really aggregate the audiences and, you know, figure out which audience we're going to target depending on which problem we're going to solve and getting more personal and precision based in our marketing. The same with, you know, more addressable content, obviously, to get the right message to the right person. The same in terms of building that social listening infrastructure, because I have a big belief, which is that is sort of the linchpin to consumer closeness, which I think you opened with being close to the consumer was very important. But I want a world where, you know, social media is fueling sort of data-inspired creativity. And so, you know, the things we do creatively are based on some of the things that are extremely culturally relevant at the time, or the same could be said for data-inspired innovation, where, you know, you're seeing what sort of the hot flavors are, or the hot fragrances, or, you know, the hot ingredients, and building that into, you know, your fast cycle innovation and putting something out really quickly against that. So those are sort of the things that are part of this data infrastructure that we're building, and it's a lot of fun to build that out, let me tell you.
Well
it's a lot of work.
Well, I think what the part that makes it interesting is, of course, the application, right? And I think one of the things that we are guilty of in this industry too often is spending time talking about the infrastructure for infrastructure's sake and not spending enough time on the application.
Yes.
Listen, of course the infrastructure has to be there to do these things, but you've mentioned a lot of the key words, personalization, experiences, dynamic content.
Yep.
That's a whole ecosystem of stuff. And as you mentioned, you're a global marketer. This is not about doing it in one country. This is about doing it around the world.
Right.
Against this notion of being a more personalized, you know, relevant marketer around the world, hey, you put in the infrastructure, and again, that's certainly not done, but it's building. One of the things we often say is in order to enable these new applications that you want to do, you have to measure new things.
Yes.
Right? So I'm interested in your perspective on how you're evolving really that the business metrics that enable you to do something that I think we inherently as marketers know is right.
Yep.
We know more personalization, more relevant, more experience-driven marketing will be beneficial, but our marketing metrics typically don't enable that very well.
Yeah.
How are you navigating that?
So as part of sort of that data analytics infrastructure that we're building, we're moving to sort of agile ROI measurement processes. So I'm still talking ROI. We're still looking at, you know, everything we're doing, to your point of not just building infrastructure for the case of infrastructure. Everything we're doing is about getting better, you know, performance on our business. And at the end of the day, what our ultimate goal is we want more people using Johnson & Johnson products more often around the world. I mean, it's that simple because we help people live more vibrant lives. So we want them to use our products. So we're measuring that. And what we're seeing with this personal marketing is that the return is far greater, far greater. And, you know, in some cases, 2 to 3 times as strong, but definitely better than sort of the mass, you know, spray and pray sort of approach that we've taken for many, many years. And I mean, it's not rocket science as to the why. All of a sudden, you're getting the right message, the right person, the right time, which is the 101 of marketing and messaging targeting.
Right.
But we really couldn't do it before. And now we can do it. So I can look at, you know, potential, you know, prime prospects for a new product. I can look at, you know, if I've got a business where there might be some defectors, I can look at, you know, those defectors and sort of say, okay, I don't want those people to defect from me. What kind of message could I give them that might bring them back into my franchise or my business? So I can solve real behavioral problems versus that typical attitudinal problem. And that, I think, is what gives you the better return.
Yeah. And as you say you can do that, as you think about 2018, I'm guessing you want to do that at more scale, right? I mean, clearly it's doable, but it's not what's driving yet, is it? Is that fair?
Yes. So, definitely, that's the thing that I actually always say internally. It's personal or precision marketing at scale. Because I think that's the myth sometimes where people think, oh, I've got to target like this.
Two people, right?
Get two people. But we're doing it at scale. And so we're seeing, you know, it impact the business because we're able to do it at scale. And we obviously do that through lookalike targeting and all of those, you know, things that we build off of sort of, again, what that behavioral thing is we're trying to solve.
So how is this conversation changing the way you approach your partners, be it media companies, be it agencies, media or creative, be it content partners?
Yep.
It's, you know, that you need the ecosystem in order to make this work.
Yep.
How I assume you're pretty lean forward in helping in pushing them to provide you different solutions as well.
Yeah. So I think, you know, if I think about various partners, I mean, in some cases, partners we've been with for a very long time, sometimes we're seeing gaps in the data. And we're really working with them on how could we, you know, fill those gaps in the data, because we need to have a holistic view of sort of share of growth and sort of the entire, you know, world. So pushing in that area. I think with other partners who have, you know, traditionally, you know, even the outsource of a lot of our data, we're working with them much more closely in terms of what are you going to do versus what are we going to do kind of thing. So I think it is a team sport, because you always have to, in any business, you've got to decide what are you going to insource, what are you going to outsource, right? Because it's not just building infrastructure for the sake of infrastructure, as you said. And in some cases, it's much better to build it with a partner who does this for many other partners, and you get the scale of that IT investment, you get the scale of the learning, you get the scale of the constantly changing environment.
Yeah. It felt like over the last 12 plus months that the different partners in the ecosystem, again, media companies, content companies, agencies of all shapes and sizes, have been much more lean forward, and that the conversation is changing. And again, we've been at this conversation for many, many years, but it was, I think, we were at the bleeding edge. Now maybe we're at leading edge, we're coming to mainstream. Are you seeing the same thing? Are you... I'm guessing at this point that your partners are as much as wanting to help push you as you have to push them. Is that fair?
I think that's very fair to say. I think what's changed, or if I just look at from my world, what's changed is we now have things that we're doing. Mm. So maybe 3 years ago, we were talking about this stuff a little more. Now we're actually doing stuff. So I gave you a couple of examples, you know, Neutrogena.com, I gave you Neutrogena 360. Yeah. I could give you examples of things we're doing in terms of innovation on Listerine, you know, local flavors we're launching, green tea, Miswak, that we're getting through sort of our data infrastructure of where the opportunities might lie. So we're doing stuff, and in doing stuff, you actually, it gets back to my fail forward piece.
Sure.
You're learning what's working, what's not working. What do we really need? Do we really need that? No, we don't need that. Okay, we need this. So it allows us to actually tinker in a real world versus right. sort of talking about the world that's right. out there right. and big data and, you know, right. more data coming in every minute than, you know, existed 100 years ago. I mean, that's the difference.
That's right. We don't have to talk about paradigm shiftings with data infrastructure for the 21st century marketer.
Exactly.
We can actually do it. So in the last few seconds we have, I guess, as you think about all this, then again, as you stare at the beginning of 2018, if we're having this conversation at the end of the year, what will make you feel like you got where you wanted to be in 2018?
Okay, so I think if I have some brilliant fail forwards at the James Burke Awards that are coming up this August, I think that will be a real huge measure. We're doing a lot of things in terms of measuring like the time to market for our innovation and have we reduced that, and so that's another big measure. I think just the degree finally to the examples that I'm getting in from around the world. So the interesting thing is I look out today and I definitely feel like, you know, there's many more exciting, differentiating things that are coming my way. People using influencers to pre-sell products before they hit the market for launch, or people setting up actually a whole pre-book phase of selling of products. So just these examples that are coming in are coming faster, and that to me is a measure of success right. because that ultimately says that the organization is engaging and the organization is owning it. Until you get your organization to own it, the reality is nothing is going to happen.
It'll happen. So. Makes a lot of sense. Alison, appreciate your time this morning.
Great.
It's been great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great discussion. Thank you, everyone.